Tu te souviens, la semaine dernière dans Velvet Jungle, on a eu un petit avant-goût de notre invité de ce soir, Boy George. C'est ici à Paris que je l'ai rencontré dans son restaurant macrobiotique préféré. Mais enfin, tout ça, c'est juste une histoire de chapeau. Boy George, tout de suite.
Every time you put out an album or a song, it always seems like people are saying it's a comeback. Everyone's always waiting for you to do something. Why is that, do you think?
Well, I suppose when you, I mean, when you've been as successful as I was with Culture Club, and then, there was a sort of dull, dark period. Everything you do after that is a comeback. It gets on my nerves because I never stopped making records. For the last 7 or 8 years since I left Culture Club, I've made a lot of records. I've had a kind of up and down career, but I wouldn't call what I'm doing now a comeback. I mean, it's just journalistic media terms, I don't really pay too much attention to it, but it kind of aggravates me a bit.
The album is called Cheapness and Beauty. Are you attracted to both?
Well, I think that both things are relative. One man's idea of beauty may be another man's idea of absolute ugliness. But I'm attracted to, it's like, you know what a magpie is?
The bird.
Yeah, well, they sort of attracted to glittery things. So it's really about that, cheapness and beauty. And sort of frailty. I mean, the song Cheapness and Beauty is really about being in love and being in love with kind of lost souls. If you listen to the words of the song, it's more explanatory.
And are you like lost souls?
Well, I suppose I am a lost soul in some ways, and so I think most gay people are lost souls. Because I think for the most informative years of your life, you're not really allowed to be who you are. And there isn't any encouragement of your emotions. So there's a part of you that always feels separate, and there's another part of you that always wants to belong. So I think it's really all to do with that. I mean, the whole album is really autobiographical. It's very much in line with my book, which is coming out soon. And writing the book and writing the album at the same time did stir up a lot of memories. So it's very much stories from my childhood, stories from now, lots of things like that.
Your autobiography, it starts when you were a kid? Or what age does it start?
It starts from as early as I can remember because a lot of my early childhood I don't actually remember. So there's vivid memories of childhood and huge chunks that are missing. Probably stuff that I don't want to remember. But I remember one of my earliest memories was sort of really loving Shirley Bassey. So it starts off with when I was a little boy, I wanted to be like Shirley Bassey. That's how the book starts.
Goldfinger and all.
I remember one of my first favorite songs was Never, Never, Never. Do you know this one?
No.
I'd like to run away from you, and if I could, I would, but I would die.
Oh, yeah, really?
High drama. I've always been a bit of a drama queen.
What were you like as a little kid? Were you flamboyant or were you private or?
Well, it's quite hard to be private in a family of six kids. We lived in a very, very small house, four boys in one room. So it was very hard to have any privacy. But I used to wander a lot as a kid. I was a walker. I used to go off on sort of walking adventures, just kind of. Sometimes I would walk for like 8 or 9 hours and then sort of end up somewhere in the middle of nowhere and freak out. But I did a lot of walking as a kid, and I did used to like being on my own. But I was quite friendly, quite, gregarious. All my friends were girls when I was a kid. It was always girls swapping beads and singing pop songs. It was always girls.
The first single of the album is Fun Time. It's a cover of Iggy Pop and David Bowie. Why did you choose to do a cover?
Why not?
Is it because everything I own did so well and this is a great
cover? It's not really that conscious. I mean, I like to do covers on my albums. There's a lot of songs that I'd love to cover. And in fact, when we did Fun Time, it was never ever intended to be the first single. When you mix an album, you go for the track that kind of says that sets the album up. It's not necessarily about being number one or it being a cover or anything like that. And in fact, this record, is a kind of challenge because a lot of the radio stations are saying, well, it's too hard, or...
Yeah, that's what I wanted to talk
it's
about.
It's not Boy George.
It's, you know? It's a new sound for Boy. It's sort of a dirty sound. It's an, I like it, though. It's different.
I mean, you know, no one ever says to a painter, why isn't your painting like the last one? And it's the curious thing about pop music that it's turned into this kind of almost like market strategy. Mm-hmm. You know, like when you turn on MTV, it's like watching adverts. Everything is so perfect. Everything is so premeditated. Mm-hmm. And I suppose what I'm going for with this album, with this song, is the kind of rawness. I mean, you know, the album was recorded in 5 weeks very quickly, mm-hmm. avoiding all the old cliches, all the old ways of recording. I'm really going for passion rather than perfection. And for me, it is a kind of backlash against the kind of pretty boy, manufactured mm-hmm. stuff that's being churned out of the airwaves, which I, you know, I can suffer the most trashy pop music as long as it comes from the heart. But when it's kind of manufactured and premeditated by some fat cat in a studio, then I object to it. Mm-hmm. So it's a kind of rebelling against all that, really.
There are songs also quite pop, but the sound definitely has changed. It's a little less...
I think people want to keep you in a corner. People want to sort of think of me as this kind of chirpy little pop persona. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if people followed my career for the last 5 years, they'd see that I've gone through lots of changes. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'll just continue to do whatever I want to do. I mean, that's what all you can do as an artist.
Saying with Culture Club, do you really want to hurt me? I think it was quite clear that you were homosexual. But in this,
it was obvious.
I think it was obvious. Maybe not, but I think so. And now in these songs, you talk about your homosexuality. You talk about homosexuality in general, mm-hmm. and it's much more, like you said, it's coming more from your heart. It's funny. It seems like for the first time you're talking about it from maybe helping someone who's going to be listening to your album at home or. Well, hasn't come out, or
I'd like to think that I was driven by those pure motives. But I think that, you know, songs are like, for me anyway, they're like exorcisms. You know, they can be a means of revenge. Mm-hmm. You know, purging. I think that songs help you work through problems. So a lot of my songs are questions. I mean, they're not answers as such, but they're questions. You know, songs like "God Don't Hold a Grudge," it's a question. I mean, I feel, in some ways, I feel quite defiant, and in other ways, I'm quite unsure, because I think that one never knows any of the answers. You just have to kind of do what you feel in your heart, mm-hmm. and the rest of it hopefully will fall into place. But if people do read my book and listen to this album and feel inspired, feel confident, then I've done a good job, because I think music can play that role. It doesn't have to. But I think music should be, it should either make you laugh or cry.
Mm-hmm. But you did say to me that you thought that it was important to listen to the lyrics. That
you
hope that in Absolutely. Other countries, like in France, that people are going to be listening to you and they have your lyrics, that you're hoping that they'll understand them.
I mean, for me, you know, all the people that I've loved throughout history have been people who have really concentrated on writing great songs, people like Joni Mitchell, people like Morrissey. I mean, there are a lot of people writing great songs. A lot of the time, what gets passed off as a great song, to me, is just dross. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, people who get called geniuses today, I just think it's a joke, really. Mm-hmm. You know, when you listen to sort of Joni Mitchell or Bob Dylan, you know, that's kind of really vivid, it's really picturesque, it's moving, it's special. Mm-hmm. And I think that in a way, the downside of technology computers is that it's made pop music more accessible, but it hasn't made pop music better. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, and you can't program emotions. I mean, I think technology is really important and it's a way forward, but in some ways it's also a way backwards, you know, because there aren't as many people learning instruments as there were 20 years ago. And I think that music is suffering because of that. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, when you make dance music, you can get away with not really being able to play.
Right.
But it's still, you still can't necessarily write a great song unless you have the talent to do so. Mm-hmm. So you get a lot of this kind of real, what I call, sort of Euro cheese, sort of German kind of Nazi pop music, which I just really hate.
It's quite fleeting.
It's fleeting, but also it's like, you know, radio stations generally have a responsibility, as do filmmakers. You know, they have a kind of certain amount of control over the airwaves. And I'm beginning to think that they don't like music. I think what it is that a lot of DJs now have turned into personalities, whereas like in the 60s and the 70s, you actually had DJs who loved music and they knew about music, they went to concerts. Now you've kind of got celebrities who tell jokes and do these kind of comedy sketches, and they know nothing at all about music, not a thing. And it's so insulting to go onto their shows and be interviewed by people who know nothing about what you've done or nothing about the past. It's just ridiculous.
I could live, I could die, I could be reborn in your arms. Oh, baby, little baby, I could laugh, I could cry, I could sigh, if you're there, keep me warm, do keep me warm.
Listen, talking about drinks, we're in a macrobiotic restaurant in Saint-Germain. Tell me about that. I mean, it seems like clean living is doing
well, French people,
well by you.
French people always think I'm completely insane when I say that my favourite restaurants in Paris are Gwen Mai and Le Bon Ambois, because they say, well, French food is so delicious, how could you? But I actually much prefer to come and eat something healthy. Because, you know, well, I don't eat meat and I don't eat dairy or sugar. And if I had a choice, you know, I mean, when I'm traveling, you know, I'd rather eat macrobiotic food any day, because I know where it's coming from. I know that it's clean. Mm-hmm. I know that it's doing me good. And I actually enjoy the taste. I mean, some people, I brought friends to restaurants like this and they're like, how can you eat this? But I actually do really enjoy it.
And do you miss ever like a nice hamburger or?
No.
When did this start? Was this after your sort of fall from grace, if I can call it like that?
Well, I wouldn't look at it like
no,
that.
No, tell me, what was it? Tell me what was happening.
That sounds like one of those journalistic terms.
No, but I was just saying, you had a plunge, you know, what can I say?
Well, I mean, I think that the nature of our lives is that we're always plunging and resurging. I mean, you know, Buddhism teaches you that heaven and hell is a kind of constant state of being and that you're always going through both. So, you know, I'm sure there will be other times in my life when there's going to be, you know, dark moments, but I suppose I'll deal with them differently. But I'm coming back to the whole food thing, I suppose. Yeah, I mean, when I came off drugs, I was pretty unhealthy. I looked terrible. And I started to kind of be more conscious about what I was putting into my body.
What does religion play in your life?
Well, I don't really have any particular religion. Let's just clear this up right now, once and for all.
No, because you did come out a couple of years ago with Hare Krishna, and so...
You know, I've kind of plundered a lot of religions, and I've read a lot about different philosophies, I've read lots of different books, and, you know, I am actually very good friends with the Christian devotees. I have some really, really close friends in England that I visit regularly for food, and we chant. The last time I was in Paris, I went to the church in Montmartre and I lit some candles. I do that when I'm in Rome. I like sort of, it's almost like it's a way of acknowledging, you know, God, whoever you choose it or him to be. When you go to places like India and you see the starvation and hunger, sort of saying kind of prayers for your food and grace, it makes a lot more sense. Mm. I think in the West, we're just really, we forget about all those things. We're too busy being busy.
Is it a guilt? Do you think a religion can also serve as like a guilt trip thing?
Well, I think if it serves as a guilt trip thing, then it's wrong. Then it's kind of missing the point. I don't think it should ever be something that you feel guilty about. And I also don't think that religion should be something that's necessarily passed on. I think that in schools, everything should be taught and people should be allowed to make their own choices. Mm. But that isn't the way it is. But certainly, I think if you go to a religion through choice, then it's a lot more meaningful to you. It has a lot more power.
Growing up, did you ever was your family religious?
I say in my book that there was a picture of the Pope next to a picture of Muhammad Ali.
Okay.
So, you know, my parents are, they're not strictly religious, but they believe in God. Mm-hmm. My mother goes to church, my father goes to church. But they don't kind of, it's more as a kind of, more as for a sense of peace, really. And, you know, just to kind of, as I say, to acknowledge that higher power, but they're not kind of fanatical, never have been.
You have the choice of keeping one beauty product, one makeup. You can't take anything else, just one. Which one would it be?
It would be my boyfriend.
Oh, okay.
He's the best beauty product I have.
Thanks. Très bien. Très bien.